We are beginning with next segment in our syllabus. We covered forms of literature or genres of literature previously. Now we are starting with history of literature. And the history of literature then has parts in it. We are dealing with the first part, which is medieval and early modern literature. A natural question would be, why should we know the history of literature? The answer to that question is because historical context matters when we try to understand a piece of writing. It is important to know in what time a certain piece of literature has been written, and also it is important to know in what time the piece of literature has been set. So, any play, for example, Shakespeare's play, written in 17th century, if we forget about its context when it was written, and we assume that it has been written by somebody in recent times and we try to read Shakespeare's work, basically we would be totally confused, because the literary text will have that kind of vocabulary, those kind of expressions which are not used these days. So we will be confused because we won't be aware of the kind of language Shakespeare has used at that time. So in order to understand Shakespeare in a better way, we need to understand what we call early modern English, the English of that time. Of course, we can read the modern version of Shakespeare, but that is something else. I'm talking about the original text. So this is the importance of knowing the historical context of any literary piece of writing. Also, sometimes we read a text and it has been set in a particular time in history. For example, you might have heard about a very common phrase in literature. It is called partition literature. Any idea what partition literature might mean? Think about it.
Different types
of literature. Okay. Any more thoughts? Partition literature? I'm sure almost all of you are aware of it. Very good. Yes. Okay. So, what does partition evoke in your mind? Partition. Which partition?
Modern and historical.
Okay. What else? Partition in your own historical context.
1947.
Very good. 1947. That is one major political partition that we are all aware of. Partition literature is the literature which has been written about the immediate consequences of the partition of the subcontinent into Pakistan and India. In order to understand a text of partition literature, you must be aware of the political movements and the social context of the partition itself. Otherwise, if you read a text about partition, it won't make any sense to you. Well, you can enjoy it as a reading, you can enjoy the story, but you cannot understand the real details of the incidents which are being described over there. So what was, for example, Hindu-Muslim conflict? Was it real? Was it affected? Was it political construction? What was the reality? Things of those kinds, you won't be aware of them. So somebody can write partition literature or partition novel even today, but when they write a literature text today, they will set it in those times. Okay, so they will read books of history about the partition and then they will write a story about those times. That also is a possibility. So we should be aware of both things. Number one, when the literature was written, that is the first thing. And the second thing is, in what times a literary piece has been set. So there are some texts which are being written even today about World War I, about World War II. Okay, so people read the history of those times and then they write a literary text about that. So we need to be aware of when the literary piece or in what times the literary piece has been set. So we need to be aware of the history of literature so that we can properly contextualize it in its proper historical context. So there, the issues, historically speaking, issues keep changing. For example, 300 years ago in England, the important issues which the people in England were facing were the issue of starvation, poverty, child labor, unemployment. What is it?
Early marriages.
Okay. Yes, point well taken. That is true. Issues, these were the issues which people in England were facing 300 years ago or 200 years ago. But probably none of the issues exist today. None of these issues exist today in today's England. Rather, these days, issues are different. For example, there is an issue of Brexit. Have you heard about it? Which is separation of Britain from the rest of Europe. Very good. Or there are issues like pandemic, COVID-19. All right? So, depending upon in what time literature is being written, the issues reflected in them are different. That is why we need to be aware of the historical context. Also, as I already said, modes of expression are different. Because the person who writes that book or that novel or that short story lives in that historical situation, observes everything around. And when she or he writes about them, there is a natural connection between both of them. Manto, for example, Sadr Hasan Manto, he wrote a lot about partition. And he pointed out that partition was a mere madness, because the politicians were fighting over the issues which were not issues at all. And his view was that we should prefer humanism over any religion. All right? So he was connected with his own times. So he was writing about them in a literary manner. And then language is different. I already pointed out that language and way of expression in all times are different. That is why we need to be aware of the historical context of those times when a certain piece of literature is produced. Now, the first known age in English history is called medieval age, or the literature produced in that age is called medieval literature. And the time frame, roughly the time frame for that is 450 to 1500 century. So, this is the time which is called the Middle Ages. Some people call them Dark Ages. Where? In today's Britain. Why those ages are called the Middle Ages? The ages between 450 to 1500. Why that time is called Middle Age or Middle Ages? The reason for that is, historians believe that before the Middle Ages, before this time, before 450 century, there was a time of glory in the Western civilization in the form of Greek and Roman civilization. There were big philosophers, big scientists, big discoverers, Plato, Aristotle, you know. These were all Greek philosophers or scientists for that matter. So that was a golden period in the history of Western civilization. That is said to be the initial period of glory. And then historians believe that after 1500, once again, there was a rise there was a development in Western civilization. There was progress in Western civilization. So the time starting from 450 to 1500, it is kind of sandwiched between two golden periods. All right? That is why this medieval time or these dark ages, they are also called the Middle Ages. So the Western civilization kind of collapsed in 5th century. Okay? And then there was the Renaissance or there was redevelopment in 16th century. Yeah, I'll come to that. I have a separate slide for that. So the medieval period is divided into further two historical times. One is called the Old English period, the other one is called Middle English period. Now, what is Old English period? Old English period is the earliest period about which or in which a little bit literature was produced. So the earliest literature which is available to us in written form comes from Old English period. Before that, there was no written literature. It was only oral tradition. And then the Middle English comes after Old English. That is the time when the initial literature flourished further. So Beowulf is name is title of a poem which was written in Old English period. That is, this is one of the first pieces of writing available in English literature. Basically through the language. I will show you two examples right now. So oldest literary work in Old English is Beowulf. This is the name of a poem. It is so old that we don't know its author. But it's a huge poem of 3,000 lines. In many schools, they still teach it, even in Pakistan. So this is a heroic narrative poem of about 3,000 lines. This belongs to Old English period. Here is an example of Old English period or Old English writing. Now, if you look at this text, students, this one, this is almost unreadable for us. It looks like some Greek and Roman language, but not English. A poet, Seamus Heaney, he translated these lines into modern English. So the translation of these lines is, "So the spear Danes in days gone by and the kings who ruled them had courage and greatness. We have heard of those princes' heroic campaigns." This is the modern English translation of these lines from Beowulf. These lines are from the poem Beowulf. So you can get a very clear idea of how old this English was. And if you ask about the time, this was 7th century.
So, what is the poem about?
The poem is a heroic narrative. So basically the poem is about mythical heroes who are fighting with each other. Okay, and a narrative, that is a story, has been written about their kind of adventures, their fights, and the poem has been written, and the narrative has been written in verse form. That is why it is a poem. So what were the characteristics of Old English poetry? The Old English poetry, or Old English literature for that matter, had the following characteristics. One, there was blending of Christian and pagan ideas. What do we mean by pagan ideas? What is it?
Pagans who attack.
Attack? Those who attacked? you said?
Yes.
So basically pagans are the people who are non-believers, who do not believe in God. They are called pagan. Pagan are the people who believe in myths.
Superstition.
Not atheist, because atheists do not believe in any metaphysical entity. But these people, pagans, they are the ones who believe in idols and who worship idols. Not superstitious, no. Well, believers can also be superstitious. So pagan are the people who believe in idols and worship them. Alright? On the other hand, Christians are people who believe in God and who do not believe in idols. Alright? So there was a blending of Christian themes and pagan themes in this poetry. And the reason for that was there was an influence of Greek civilization on Old English, and as you know that Greek believed in idols. They had idols, you know, idols of various gods. On the other hand, Christian, they believed in Bible. So in the poetry of Old English, you can find a blend of both the themes. And then there was emphasis on ritual, royal authority, and storytelling in this Old English poetry. So royal authority, because that was the time of monarchy. Storytelling, because these were the people who knew oral tradition a lot. So in the olden tradition, people used to tell stories, okay? They didn't write it. So there was a custom of the people belonging to a certain community to sit at one spot under, you know, under the bare sky and lit up the fire, and then one of them used to tell the story and rest of them used to listen to that.
True stories.
No, they were not true stories, of course. They were stories, you know. Story, by story we mean they are not supposed to be true. Yeah. So, from Old to Middle English, England's first great literary figure in Middle English was Geoffrey Chaucer. So, Geoffrey Chaucer is the first known English author, and he does not belong to the Old English. He belongs to the Middle English, which is a development after the Old English. And he wrote a book. Again, a book of poetry is called Canterbury Tales. Canterbury Tales is a huge book of poetry, and it is taught almost everywhere. Wherever you have an English department, it is taught over there. So even today, in master's syllabus, which the University of Punjab has for the whole Punjab. All the students do study Canterbury Tales. It's called Prologue to Canterbury Tales, just one part of it. Anyways, Geoffrey Chaucer is the first known author belonging to Middle English. There is no known author from Old English. Alright? We just know Beowulf has a poem with the title. Okay? But in Middle English, which is after Old, we have the author himself, and his name is Geoffrey Chaucer, and his work is Canterbury Tales. Canterbury Tales were about a pilgrimage for that matter. And there are quite a number of pilgrims together. And so pilgrim is a kind of, you know, visit to a holy place. All right. So they are all kind of, you know, they are shown to be Christian pilgrims, and they are ready to travel to, you know, a holy place for the sake of pilgrim. And all of them, they tell their own stories. Okay. The priest, for example, is there. The friar is there. There are quite a number of characters, whole gallery of characters. But that all is imagined. Okay. So Chaucer was famous for creating those characters out of his imagination, okay, and make them describe themselves in a worse manner. Now here is the example of the Middle English. These lines are from Canterbury Tales. If you try to read them, you can make some sense out of it. Not complete. You can make complete sense out of it if you have a dictionary of Middle English with you. It is not Greek, it is English. We can try it. Look at it. For example, full brighter was the shining of Hir. This is his. His hue. Hue nowadays is spelled as H-U-E, which means color. Hue means color. Then in the tower, the noble forged new. We know tower, we know then. This is then, not then. And then noble, we are aware of that. Forged, F-O-R-G-E-D. Forged means to make something. New means N-E-W, new. Alright? So they, almost every second word is kind of meaningful to us. So compare this with the Old English. Okay? And we can understand how much development in the language was from Old English to the Middle English.
Today
we're
studying Middle English.
The one that we use these days? No, it is pretty modern. You know, there is a lot of advancement on that. We are talking about like 1,000 years back. Okay? At least like 1,200 years back. So what are the characteristics of Middle English literature? The medieval narratives, they were powerfully moralistic. So there was idea of good and evil in the literature of medieval English. And then there was use of what we call fabliu. It is a yarn of literature. And it is verse narrative again. Probably one of the most important characteristics of medieval English was that the literature of medieval English was never reproduced in those times. Why was it not reproduced in those times?
So
reprint. Why do you think? There is an obvious answer to that.
So because not many people could write it that time.
Could not write that time? Yeah, but probably you should, you can kind of, you know, adapt your response by saying that there was no facility to rewrite at that time. So there were no printers at that time because printing technology was not invented yet. Okay, so the literature of that time was reproduced later on. But people memorized those texts and they remember it and then they put down all from the past out of their memory. And then we come to the third and the last phase of medieval English, which is called the Renaissance. It is also called early modern period. It ranges from 1500 to 1660. The word Renaissance means the rebirth. This was the time when the printing press had been invented. This was also the time when such persons or scientists were working like Copernicus and Galileo. So what was the result of the printing press? The result of the printing press was that a lot of literature was available for people to read. So the texts from Greek times, from Roman times, which were handwritten, if they were at all, or the text from Middle English, which were handwritten, if at all, then they were available for the larger audience to read. So they were printed and reprinted, which means rediscovery of classical texts and their reading. Also, because of the revolutionary ideas that Copernicus and Galileo gave, there was a change in people's behavior towards religion. So what was the revolutionary idea given by Galileo? What was the revolutionary idea given by Galileo? What was the invention by Galileo? Very famous. What was Galileo's invention? Mobile? No, it was little earlier. What was it? Telescope. And what was his discovery? What was his discovery? That sun does not revolve around the earth, rather earth revolves around the sun. And this discovery was quite disturbing for lot many people. Why? Because that was the time when people strongly believed in biblical truth, the truth that comes from the Bible. Okay, and the according to the Bible, for those people, they always believed that it is the sun which revolves around the earth. So when Galileo said that it is the earth that revolves around the sun, he was sentenced to death for that. He was sentenced to death for that. Alright? So what happened? Renaissance, rebirth. So rebirth of knowledge, rebirth of enlightenment, rebirth of new ideas. That is what this age, 1500 to 1660, is known for. So what are the characteristics of this age? One thing about the literature, The Fairy Queen by Edmund Spenser was written in this time. Then King James Bible version was written at this time. William Shakespeare, so basically this age is known for Shakespeare, 1564 to 1660.
So what does epic mean?
Epic is a big poem, you know, as big as spreading over 200 to 300 pages. So these were the characteristics of Renaissance age: discovery and exploration, anti-authoritarianism. People started questioning the authorities. And then challenges to religion. So this is the end of today's lecture about the medieval and early modern literature.